new stands and flame trench progress at Massi's, tower construction at Sanchez, Star Factory expansion at the build site, and a full stack missing from the launch site. Welcome and thanks for stopping by for this week's Starbase Flyover Update episode 35, brought to you by RGV Aerial Photography. I'm Jeff A, and I'll be your guide today as we check out the progress at SpaceX's facilities located at Starbase, Texas. So sit back and enjoy the views from 10,500 feet. Let's refer to Procky's render as we explore the Massi site, where a new ship static test fire stand is taking shape. As always, we'll start at the top right of the site where more progress has been made on the flame trench under construction. We can see concrete has been poured towards the back of the site showing the shape of the trench. An excavator has been staged ready to commence digging. Moving to the left, we can see additional pipework has been installed to the new water tanks as well as the new gas tanks installed in the formwork that was spotted in last week's episode. This system will work similarly to the water deluge system at the launch site. More pipework can be seen nearby for the water and high pressure gas systems. Over in the far corner, a new tank-like structure has arrived. This is an enclosed flare stack for methane disposal. Shifting focus to the methane part of the tank farm, we can see new stands have been installed towards the back of the power comms building, as well as additional pipework and pipe stands for the farm. Moving to the stand structure between the cryostands, we can see that it has received legs. This will be placed on top of the ship's static fire flame trench in order to allow for additional clearance between the ship's engines and the ramp below. This could even allow for the engines to be throttled up much more than they could at the launch site ship test stands. Let us know if you agree. Next, let's move to the steel staging area slash bucket fabrication area. We can see that more steel sections have arrived since the last flyover. Thanks to this render by Ryan Hansen Space, we can get a better idea of what the bucket of the flame trench might look like. Moving down, we can see the 10 trapezoidal stands have been placed on the steel embeds in the new concrete testbed area. It is not yet known what this will be used for. Next to the structural testing cage, we can see the new mystery ring has had even more sections added. Longtime members Thomas, Indian Star and Dave Avery were there for the launch. Thomas managed to get this picture of the new electrical cables getting installed for Massi's. This is a long-awaited development. And with that, on to Sanchez. First, let's have a quick look at these labelled maps courtesy of Procky. At the stand construction site, progress on the new automated booster transport stand main structure continues, with just some parts missing to complete the ring structure. To the left is an almost completed stand, so you can compare them and see how it will look in the not too distant future. If we keep rolling to the left, we see the mystery dome-like structure, then the top of the third ship engine installation stand that is still waiting for transport to Mega Bay 2. Mystery things are a common thing at Sanchez, with this one looking almost complete, with the third one under construction. Going to the tower fab area, construction of Orbital Pad B's tower top section is well underway. This section holds all the pulley systems for the chopsticks. There is a notable lack of stair sections toward the inventory tent, as they have gone to the Port of Brownsville to be installed into those tower sections as mentioned in the previous episode. Painted squares mark out staging areas for tower sections and other material. Nearby, crews have been preparing more burn plates for the top of the OLM ring. We can see a few unique shaped plates, including thinner strip-type ones. Over by the inventory tent is a pile of more burn plates. These have different shapes once again. To the right is the Raptor installation platform, which was moved here before the launch along with the dance floor. The latter has since been transported back to the launch site for work on the OLM. Closer to the Sanchez inventory tent, a new ship aft flap has been delivered, and it should soon be moved to the build site to be installed on a future ship, maybe S-32. Some booster downcomer parts have been moved to this location, most likely destined for B-14. Going down to the gas power plant, the possible extension that started going up in the past weeks didn't get any work since the last flyover. Looking over at the new parking lot site, we can see the final dimensions taking shape with the preparations of the pile caps outlining the perimeter. The centre pile cap should be for the ramp for cars to access the higher floors. It appears that the far left-hand side will be left for ground level parking and for access to the Stargate building. The new commodities tank farm has received some concrete with little other work noticeable. It is believed that this will supply consumable gases like argon to the entire Star Factory. New concrete being laid in the area next to Mega Bay 2. This area was originally a scrapyard, then later became a staging area for the Mega Bay construction. Could it be used once again as a scrapyard? Tell us what you think in the comments below. And finally, at the Rocket Garden, Booster 4 had another grid fin removed. This is beginning to look like these are the final days for this prototype that was built back in 2021. We will keep you updated on this. Now, let's go to the build site. Please refer to this labelled map of the build site from Procky as we explore the changes. Starting off with this angled view of Mega Bay 2, we notice the bottom truss beam for the door housing is staged outside, and a fill header installed near the top. Additional steel beams to be used to seal the gap between the door and the walls are staged beside the bay. Looking inside, we can see the first ship engine installation stand. Once workers have finished installing work stands in the bay, we can expect Ship 29 to roll in for preparations for static fire and flight. Looking left to the staging area in front of Mega Bay 1, we see a three ring section bound for Booster 14's forward tank. Now looking inside Mega Bay 1, we see Booster 11 on the right atop its work stand being prepared for its engine test campaign. In front of B11 is the start of B14's methane tank, and is currently six rings tall. B12 and B13 are unseen on the other two stands to the rear, with B14's LOX tank on the turntable in the front left corner. Meanwhile, Ship 31 and Ship 30 sit in the front and back of the right side of the high bay from this view. Ship 29 sits atop the turntable to the left of the door. Unseen from the air, we'll switch to this footage compiled by Vix using Labpadre cameras, capturing S29 rolling back from the launch site on March 12th following a successful three-engine spin prime. This rollback was just 2 days before its older cousin S28 launched on Booster 10 in the third integrated test flight. More on that later, but first, let's bring you up to speed on the Star Factory. Starting off at the top of the image and moving down, we first notice that a pair of offset truss columns have been raised along this piece of angled concrete. This will be the tallest columns out of all of the Star Factory, including the nose cone production section. If you're wondering what this angled hallway will be for, the lack of bridge cranes as well as the noticeable gap in footings indicating an exit at the end of the corridor leads us to conclude this will be a nose cone hallway for taller nose cone stacks. This would also explain the mysterious parapet wall on the mid-height section. Due to the four different heights of Star Factory's various phases, this wall will serve to improve the aesthetics for viewers looking on from Highway 4 and from the offices. Further down, workers are now raising a second normal height section, with only two more remaining before the expansion reaches the original Phase 1 section built 2 years ago. It definitely seems like the remaining steel needed to finish this section is already waiting nearby. Over at the border with the ring yard, double footings are dug out ahead of concrete pouring. This could indicate the presence of doorways facing the High Bay and Mega Bay, requiring additional foundations. And with concrete being broken in front of the Star Factory Phase 1, it remains unknown whether this section will be expanded by two or three footings, or all of the above. Let's check out this shot of the new office building, which will be in a C shape as seen by the perimeter boundary walls and red drainage pipes marking its footprint. In the bottom half of the C shape, new heavy-shaped dogbone-shaped footings have made their appearance, after footings in the top half were poured and covered up with dirt again. Looking over at the old solar farm location, we see it mostly covered in rebar. This area could be yet another parking lot. Over at the village, it appears that SpaceX has acquired some more of the vacant lots and started to build on them. That's it for the build site. Before moving on to check the condition of the launch site after IFT-3, be sure to leave a like and share this with your fellow space fans if you learned something new. Firstly, we'll have a quick look at this labelled map from Procky. Landing at the former parking lot and future orbital pad B site, wick drain installation continues as SpaceX removes water from underground to start construction of the future tower and OLM. As you can see, many of these little holes have been excavated around the entire site. Also here is the SpaceX crane that was laid down for launch operations. It was later raised on the 17th. The test stand is still empty, but not for long, as we expect Ship 29 to get back here ahead of static fire testing for the next flight. Can you believe how fast SpaceX is moving? On March 15th, the ship transport stand was moved to the pad, most likely for storage. This one was updated with additional guides to make it easier to align when mounting a ship. Moving into the orbital tank farm expansion area, a lot has stayed the same since the last flyover. The new tanks are not expected to be integrated into the infrastructure before Flight 4. Speaking of flight tests, let's have a rundown of Flight 3. First, let's talk about the tank farm's incredible work during propellant loading operations. On previous flights, the propellant loading sequence took roughly 97 minutes to complete, while this time it took just 53 minutes thanks to all the upgrades, like the increased number of subcoolers and pumps. So let's see what happened on the orbital launch pad. The original T0 for this flight was 7 a.m, but was delayed several times due to boats in the keep out zone. Liftoff occurred at 8:25 a.m. with no holds needed on the T-40 second mark, a first for Starship. Booster 10 ignited all 33 engines and lifted off without issue, clearing the tower and passing through max Q at T plus 1 minute and 2 seconds. At this point we were stunned to see so much onboard live flight footage. This is a huge step up in media capabilities. At T plus 2 minutes and 50 seconds, the hot staging sequence started with shutdown of all but 3 of B-10's Raptor engines, then successful ignition of the 6 engines on ship 28. After this very dynamic event, Booster 10 successfully restarted 10 additional engines to perform a 13 engine boost back burn. This was completed at T plus 3 minutes and 48 seconds, leaving B-10 on a planned trajectory back to the Gulf. After a successful re-entry to the atmosphere, there seemed to be some errors as grid fins moved excessively without achieving stable flight. With only 3 engines briefly ignited for the landing burn, the booster had no chance of recovery. SpaceX later stated on their website, "Super Heavy successfully lit several engines for its first ever landing burn before the vehicle experienced a rudd. The booster's flight concluded at approximately 462 meters in altitude and just under 7 minutes into the mission." Meanwhile, Ship 28 successfully reached its planned trajectory, including an altitude of 234 kilometers, this time to the Indian Ocean instead of the Pacific. It managed to perform 2 of the 3 planned milestones during the coast phase, which were test the payload door, transferring propellant between the tanks, and an attempt to relight an engine on orbit. After some internal onboard views confirmed movement of the payload door, it seemed like it had some issues, eventually leaving the door partially open. SpaceX announced that the in-flight propellant transfer was successful, and finally, the in-space burn of a Raptor engine didn't happen due to excessive vehicle roll rates during the coast. Incredibly, at T plus 46 minutes, Ship 28 made it to re-entry, but with that uncontrolled pitch and roll, it started tumbling, re-entering with the leeward side and the engine section several times, which isn't good. Once again, the onboard footage during re-entry did not disappoint. After an aft flap started glowing, indicating the start of re-entry, plasma could be seen building up on various parts of the ship. These re-entry images are arguably the best telecasted live views in the history of spaceflight, all thanks to the sheer size of Starship and the multiple Starlink antennas. They lost all telemetry from the vehicle at an altitude of 65 kilometers, with the end of the flight announced soon after. Damage to the launch site was minimal. Our intrepid traveller Thomas managed to get these ground shots on the day of the launch. Over on OLM, a couple of panels were blown into the dunes. There were some misplaced insulation covers on the subcoolers, and to this tank behind the electrical bunker. One cable tray near Highway 4 was bent out of shape. The OLM looks suitably charred, but with no visible damage. The BQDs and clamps have been extended, with chains supporting the latter for maintenance purposes. Hopefully this will be a speedy process and we see Booster 11 atop the launch mount soon. Some of the chopsticks walkway sections were also dislodged. Looking from this angle, it is clear that the bracing for the water and nitrogen tanks worked as planned, with no new dents visible. The water tank still bears a scar from Flight 1. On the 17th, senior writer at Space News Incorporated Jeff Faust posted on X stating, "The FAA's Calvin Coleman says at the payload space capital event this evening that he didn't see any major issues with last week's Starship launch. But SpaceX still needs to carry out a mishap investigation. SpaceX, he says, is aiming for 6 to 9 more Starship launches this year. This is great news for SpaceX for moving on with future flights." And that's it for this week's flyover. Thank you for flying with us and we hope you liked it. If so, please consider subscribing so you don't miss out on the new videos each week and leave a thumbs up on the way out. Also, consider supporting our flyovers through Patreon to gain access to our flyover gallery the same day it occurs. Finally, join our public Discord server to discuss Starship and space in general with like-minded fans around the world. The link is in the description down below. See you next week from 10,500 feet.